Hello and welcome to the Sensibly Speaking podcast. This is Chris Shelton, the critical thinker at large.
This is Ruth McLeod, the Southern Atheist.
We are coming at you for show number 45 in our long line of famous or perhaps infamous episodes of awesome greatness. We will find us on iTunes, Stitcher, at our website, sensiblyspeaking.com, and also, of course, here on YouTube for the video version of our podcast. And we would like to, as always, expand our viewership and get more of you guys on board. So please, those of you who are watching, go ahead and tell your friends and family about us and how good or horrible you think we are. We're all about it. And actually, kind of force them to listen to some sense. And I just want to say that it's actually easy to do because we are actually doing all the thinking for you. So it's really not a lot of work involved in this. Yeah.
When did you turn into Rush Limbaugh? Don't stop thinking. Please continue to think. Chris has some like delusions of grandeur that's happening right now. I'm going to need you to calm yourself down. Just scale it back. Just scale it back like times 100, then scooch it up a scotch.
Whoa.
Just.
Whoa. Okay.
But he's got a point.
We are actually the anti-Rush Limbaugh, to correctly position us. We are not interested at all, of course, in telling you what to think, but that's sort of our on a political spectrum. We would be very much at the opposite end of all things Rush, who, by the way, is very pro-Trump, which just
that frightens me. Shiver down my spine.
Exactly. All right. So first, before we get into some of our regular segments, Orlando happened last week, and we didn't really talk about it hardly at all here on the podcast, and we were not going to spend a long time on this week because, I've already put out a video about gun control and my thoughts and feelings on Orlando. Ruth expressed herself last week, and there really isn't any reason to try to milk this or talk more about it or something like that, but we did have a listener or viewer send some questions in, actually quite some time ago, when we first talked about gun control.
From the last mass shooting.
Probably
a month ago. Who knows?
Yeah, it was a while ago, right? But the questions are relevant. We never really got to them because we haven't taken up gun control as a subject. And so so I thought this might be a good time to take this up and in this way address the issue of what we think is important about this. And also we will have a news item or two that is also directly related to the Orlando thing. So first off, this is from a guy named George, and he says, I guess as a libertarian, I consider myself a free thinker, and you state you are a critical thinker. Some personal questions I would like to ask. One, you come from a Big Brother environment, and I'm assuming that's related to my Scientology background.
Right, that's what I get.
Thus, why would you want this for America? Why is big government your solution? And this is, of course, in relation to the subject of gun control. And he's saying that, the idea of putting restrictions or regulations on ownership of handguns or rifles or assault weapons is somehow equated to my idea of big government. And you want to say something first and all?
I'm just appalled at how many times the big government argument pops up. You seem to have no problem with big government stepping in almost every other aspect of your life, controlling my body personally as a woman, regulating our cars, regulating anything that we do, our food, our alcohol, what kind of drugs we can and can't have. So I don't see this as being a big government issue to not want to have someone have a machine gun or a gun that could easily wipe out 49 people within a matter of a few minutes. So I don't understand why the big government gets thrown in a lot.
Right. Of course, philosophically, I'm on the same page with Ruth. I think that there is a... you know, a real philosophic argument that occurs between liberals and conservatives and between reds and blues or black and whites or whatever, I mean, any group you want to, you know, throw up, is the question of libertarianism versus authoritarianism, right? Or totalitarianism or regulation, you know, however you want to describe that. There's a balance between these two things. You know, total libertarianism goes over into anarchy. Total conservatism or total control goes over into totalitarianism and authoritarianism as words to describe that. And we all feel that there's probably a balance somewhere in there that we are personally comfortable with. I know very few people who are actually anarchists, who actually don't want any rules whatsoever. But there are people who move in that direction when it comes to certain issues. And so this becomes a multi-layered problem because, you know, on some issues like abortion, you want all kinds of controls. And on, you know, issues like gun control, you don't want any controls. And so you find yourself being, you know, libertarian here and authoritarian over here, or, you know, shades of gray in between. So for me, it's a constant struggle looking at that and looking at how much control do I want in my life, because I'm not into big government, as I think you're describing, as I think you think of it as a free thinker or as a libertarian. I would tend to go in your direction in answering a question about big government. I don't like lots of taxes. I don't like lots of regulations and lots of controls. But on the other hand, it's a balance that we have to strike in order to live safely amongst ourselves, because we have to have laws, and we have to have people to enforce those laws, and we have to have fire departments, and we have to have somebody building the roads and doing all these things. That requires taxes. It requires all this framework that we have called our civilization or our society. So if we don't have any of that, it's every man for himself. I don't think too many people really want that, right? So but to then say, well, to have any regulation at all is big government, is an extremist argument, and it doesn't really make a lot of sense. Like Ruth said, we all want regulations of some kind to support our own personal philosophies of how we think people should be living. So how much regulation is too much is really the question, not should there be regulation. So when it comes to gun regulation, I believe very strongly that we should be moving in the direction of more regulation, because less regulation, less restriction on this subject gives us what we have. And every regulation that seems to be put on the books or seems to be going forward to try to control this problem is met with counter-regulation in greater numbers. And if you, you know, doubt this, then look at the records. Look at the voting records. Look at the gun lobby. Look at what the NRA does. Look at what these other gun lobbies do, because it's not just the NRA. And look at how they fight back against these regulations, against mandatory background checks, against age requirements, against, you know, all these various regulations, right? Some regulations are more effective than others. Those can be debated individually. You can go, well, I don't know about this particular background check problem. So good, let's take a look at that. But should there be background checks? Yes, there should, right? Should we be selling guns to people who are under investigation by the FBI? No, we shouldn't be doing that. And anybody, I don't understand how this is even like a question, but apparently to some people they think every citizen should be an armed citizen. I don't go there. And if that means I'm for big government in your eyes, I wouldn't agree with that description, but if that's how you want to look at what I'm saying, that's my position on it. So, next question. Tell me, where is it? Nope. Yes, here it is. Tell me, how do guns kill people? How do objects cause harm? Rather, does that not take away from personal responsibility? You want to, anything to say on that?
When someone can explain to me what kind of animal that you need a high-powered rifle for, or a quick reload rifle, what are you hunting? If when somebody can explain that to me, then I will be happy to say that guns don't kill people, people kill people. Do I think that guns just automatically fire and kill a bunch of people? Of course not. do they fall over and kill a toddler every now and then? Yeah. Yeah, the sons of bitches do. But that absolutely has something to do with the person who has or owns said rifle. And if you don't have the kind of regulations that we are asking for people to have, or the background, or even the training to have a gun, you shouldn't fucking have one. And until that day, I will absolutely say that a gun is going to kill somebody, because the person who's handling it doesn't know how to use it. So yeah, I say that.
And as far as my reply on this goes, one, you know, no, guns don't just, you know, sit there on a table and kill people. I mean, duh. A gun, however, and to make this, to differentiate the gun argument from other implements or tools that are used to kill people, a gun has a specific, it was designed and invented for a specific reason, and that was to harm or kill somebody. It doesn't have another function. Sporting uses of guns and hunting uses of guns came after the fact of inventing guns to kill other people. That is why they came about. So that tool has that specific function. A knife, a car, a hammer, these are tools that are actually invented for and used for a broad variety of purposes that have nothing to do with killing people. You can kill somebody with an Xbox if you want to. That doesn't mean we should ban all Xboxes, right? We have a violent nature, and sometimes that comes out, and we grab the first thing, you know, that we can get hold of and use it to hurt other people sometimes. But that's a truism of almost any, you know, item or object, but a gun is a specific thing that has that purpose. So I will say that about it. Now, you said, what about personal responsibility? Well, of course, anybody who uses any of these devices to harm, maim, or kill somebody else is personally responsible for it. I don't even know how that's even a question. But I've never tried to take away anybody's personal responsibility for their own actions. Every mass shooter who executed a mass shooting, everybody who pulls the trigger should be held responsible for their actions.
And they are.
Right. I'm not sure what I said that might, or, you know, that prompted that question, but
a kid that gets a hold of his parents' gun and shoots the neighbor boy or something, who gets in trouble? The parents.
Yeah.
That's...
As they should.
As they should,
because parents are responsible for the actions of their children, as they should be, because the kids are not of age where they can necessarily fully understand or be responsible for their actions. That's the society we live in. Those are the agreements we've made in this society. So that's how we're going to roll.
He's like, well, you're taking away personal responsibility if you blame the gun. No. The fact is that Americans can go out and buy a gun with, yeah, sure, I can probably get one with a background check. I've never been arrested.
It'd be easy for either one of us to get a gun.
Either one of us can get one. But the thing is, we don't have a regulation that shows me how to fucking use one.
Right.
I fired a gun once in my life, and I didn't like it, so I've never done it again.
And I have shot guns. I did enjoy it. I thought it was a hell of fun. But that doesn't mean that, you know, I think that they should be freely accessible to anybody who wants one.
Right.
I just don't, right? And I actually think I've said before that regulating ownership of guns based on training is a really good idea.
It's
in the same way
that
you regulate car ownership, right? You can't just go get a car and go drive it off the lot. You have to produce this thing called a driver's license.
Right.
And in order to get a driver's license, you have to go take classes. Now, we can have the argument about whether those classes are adequate to the purpose, right?
Right.
And I think that's a debate to be had, right? And maybe the same could be had about gun licenses and gun training and that sort of thing. I'm all about that. I think that would be a very... rational, sensible regulation to put on anybody who's going to buy a gun. Yeah, no, pull out your license, dude. Let's see that you're trained to use this thing before we sell it to you.
Right.
All right. He says here, three, I first heard the argument about gun control and the Holocaust in my freshman year of college in 1991. This is not a new concept. I don't know. We're not even going there. I mean, this is this idea that, you know, if the Jewish people in the ghettos had weapons, that they could have prevented, you know, the Holocaust. I think that is ignorant in the extreme, given the all the circumstances that surrounded that situation. And I think that requires a more well-rounded look at history.
Yeah.
I think that's a very knee-jerk reaction to a historical tragedy. Four, as Americans, we live in a country which is about, from its founding, individual rights versus group collective societal control, which I just discussed, the philosophical differences. The basic issue about guns in America stands that it is a right, not a privilege, that can be revoked on a whim. Okay. I guess you're talking referring to the Second Amendment.
It's not really a question. That's a statement.
Yeah. Yeah, he makes a few statements here, and I'll just, I guess we can just comment on this. Our revolutionary history makes us a more violent society since our founding and the manifest destiny of making a true continental state. The current, I guess that's like you're referring to Western expansion. The current violence is based on the denigration of societal values since the 1960s. The mass media and popular culture are main factors. This is a not very deep statement to be made about violence in our society. Gun violence goes all the way back to Samuel Colt in the Old West when we had guns, and even before that, I mean, as far back as muskets. So to say this goes back to the 1960s and we've, you know, been we were a perfect society all through the 1950s, and then somehow when LSD hit the scene and cultural revolution occurred with protests of Vietnam and civil rights and all this sort of thing, that somehow society denigrated into, you know, the lawless anarchy that it is now or something. And of course, I'm being extreme to make a point. This is not a view that I agree with, that I will readily agree with. Jon Stewart actually did the most beautiful thing on The Daily Show one time, and I'll probably dig up the link to it and put it in the notes for the show here, where he actually walked through every decade of the 20th century and showed how the good old days were not the good old days, right? For every generation going all the way back to the 1920s, how, you know, there's this thing that happens where it's a conservative view. And I don't mean that from a right-wing political thing. I mean, it's truly the definition of the word conservative. It's trying to go back to older times and older values as though those earlier times were better than they are now. And saying, boy, if things were like they were when I was a kid or when I grew up, you know, and society was so much better than it is now. And he did a way better job than I'll ever do at showing the falsity of that argument. Right, by taking it back decade by decade. So I'll just put a link up on that. I'll find that on YouTube or something and throw that up there. But that's basically my reply to this idea. You have anything you wanted to say?
No,
on that?
If you think that we need to go back before the 1960s when America was great, you can just jump right on the Trump train and ride your ass to hell.
Okay. All right. So. Yeah, and he made some other points here, which we're not going to get into because I think we've spent enough time on this about other countries and their gun control and this sort of thing. But honestly, when you brought up Uganda and Zimbabwe as examples of countries that have, you know, gun control and militarization and stuff, and that being somehow proof that, you know, enforcing laws here would somehow, you know, I don't know. It's a weird argument and one that I don't really want to get into anymore. So
I like how he brought up Swiss and how all of them have guns and everything's fantastic. That's because they have great regulation.
Right. Yeah. There's a little bit more to that argument. This is sort of like, let's all move to Norway because it's the happiest country in the world, right? And everybody makes $20 an hour minimum wage, and it's all so wonderful there. And you kind of get this idea from memes of people frolicking in the fields in Norway, right? And it's like, come on, guys. Norway is like the size of Rhode Island. I mean, it is so apples and oranges when you start taking European countries as a case study of what the United States should be. They don't compare in so many ways.
Yeah, and it would be great if we could all pay, you know, an ungodly amount of taxes to make all this stuff happen, but that's not going to happen here. Because the last time we tried to do, you know, major taxes, like, tea ended up in a harbor, and all of a sudden we're in a fucking crazy-ass war. Like...
Right. I mean, there's good points to be made on that. It's, you know, I don't think anybody in the United States wants a 50% income tax bracket. I don't think anybody wants that. And that's how some of these European countries do what they do.
Right.
And that's just one point. There's cultural differences, there's historical differences, there's economic differences, there's so many. Don't take one little thing I say and then go, oh, you're so wrong because blah, 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 blah. Look, I know, it's a very complex issue when you start comparing one country to another.
Right.
On these issues. So it's not just,
I mean, even
easy peasy.
Even going from the Northwest to the Southeast or, you know, the other ways to do it, it's just... It's like going into different countries. You need a passport to go to places like Alabama and stuff like that. It's crazy. And so if we have that big of a culture shock within our own country, how the hell do you expect us to adopt like Norway's concepts or right. Swiss's concepts?
Right. And somebody could come after me right now for the fact that I proposed the Australian solution on gun control. But, you know... That is a specific example of where I think another country that is actually very similar to us on this matter got it right and did something that was very bold and very brash and very, very forward thinking, and they had a positive result from it. So my suggestion is really a suggestion, knowing full well that, you know, the American public are not going to go for something like that for quite some time. But if we don't push it and start pushing something forward,
don't understand why we can't even sit down and have like a civilized conversation within our own lawmakers' houses and things. I mean, we have to resort to things like
let's talk about the news now. Okay, in the news, the first thing we're going to take up is actually something that happened yesterday and today. Now, we're recording this again on Thursday, posting on Saturday, so it'll be a couple days ago. But this was reported on today, and there's some pluses and minuses as far as commentary on this, but first let's talk about the story. This was a sit-in that was staged by House Democrats in Congress over gun control. And they basically, John Lewis, who's a congressman from Atlanta and a legendary civil rights leader, and other congressmen, and I think they were actually joined, who's the congresswoman who came over?
Elizabeth Warren?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. For some reason, I was thinking Nancy something. Anyway, Elizabeth Warren came over.
You're trying to put in Nancy Pelosi.
No, yeah. And I was like, that's wrong.
No.
It was not her. Anyway, bunch of congressmen literally sat down on the floor of Congress protesting the fact that Congress was not moving forward on any legislation. And in fact, within days of the Orlando mass shooting was... vetoing or canceling proposed gun legislation or legislation that was attached to other bills. Now, before we all get, you know, too crazy about this stuff, the fact of the matter is that it is true that a lot of amendments get added to bills that are unsavory or not wanted in the first place. And so you put an amendment onto it in order to push it through. It's not its own legislation.
Right.
And then, because the bill that it's being amended to sucks, you get people who can't vote for it in good conscience. And so then they're perceived as not voting for the gun legislation, which was really just an amendment on a larger bill. So I'm not sitting here saying that, all the Republicans in the House and the Senate are all just a bunch of, you know, gun nuts and this sort of thing. Because I don't know all the complications behind the most recent amendments that were trying to be passed. And I'm not going to sit here and pretend to.
Right.
And the press and the media likes to, you know, confuse and cloud these things and make it seem like some of our politicians are acting in ways that they're really not.
Right.
And they don't get a fair shake all the time on that. So that being said, this sit-in, I thought, was when I first saw it happening, I thought, hey, thumbs up. These guys are at least... doing some kind of protest, right? I mean, what did you think when you first heard about it?
There was a little bit of excitement, just I'm happy that they are trying to take a stand. And part of me was like, really? it took gay kids getting shot and not just elementary school kids? Cool.
I know, exactly.
But I mean, you know, I can try to be petty like that all day long. But the fact that they were actually trying to do something and actually bring media to this was fantastic.
Exactly. And Sean King, noted here on the Daily News, link below, talks about this on this in this New York Daily News article, and he said the political theater of what they did was powerful, which is correct. It was. And that's all, you know, it's good on them. Kudos. You guys staged a revolt, and, you know, and of course, Paul Ryan in full Republican, tradition, turned off the C-SPAN cameras when he left, tried to give it a media blackout. They were periscoping video from the floor, right? I mean, this was just, you know, just all sides, bicker, bicker, bicker.
That's not the first time. I mean, the Democrats did it to the Republicans in 08. We turned off the cameras when they were doing the exact same thing.
What?
Over oil. What? And drilling. Yeah, the Democrats do that too? Totally.
No way.
They fucking did it.
Okay.
Nope, just Periscope wasn't around in 08, so yeah, they couldn't do anything.
From the House floor anyway. And anyway, there's some good notes here. But Sean makes a couple points that I wanted to go over. One of them is, our country has an undeniable problem with gun violence. Mm-hmm. Tens of thousands of people a year are killed by guns all over this nation, and it is taking a serious emotional toll on all of us.
Right.
And he says here, from mass shootings in schools, churches, movie theaters, and clubs, to little children accidentally killing themselves or shooting their mothers or siblings, gun violence has long since crossed over to a point of utter ridiculousness.
Right.
While corporations rack up the profits, gun violence is tearing this country apart. I could not agree with that sentiment more. Now, if you disagree with that sentiment, I'd actually like to hear from you.
As long as you
could do it in a rational way, because I've had a couple people post on my YouTube channel, and I know YouTube and commenting sections are supposed to be the wild, wild west of the internet and all that, but I get to moderate my channel, and I feel I have a pretty loose and free moderation policy. So if you can present an argument to me that I can engage with that is not all full of what a dork I am or how stupid I am for saying what I say, I'd really appreciate it. That would be very kind of you. Maybe the wild, wild west doesn't have to be at least on this channel or my channel. Now, here's the thing about this Democrat thing. What is also true is that the primary focus of the Democratic sit-in, a policy that they are casually calling no fly, no buy, will do virtually nothing to reduce gun violence in America. Not only that, but the policy, which basically states that if an individual is on the federal government's no fly list or terrorism watch list, that they cannot legally purchase a gun in America, is actually rooted in xenophobic bigotry, which disproportionately and sometimes indiscriminately targets Muslims and immigrants from the Middle East.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and that I agree with 100% as well.
Totally.
And I've already been accused of being a, you know, no-fly list totalitarianist or something, right? Because it's assumed that I support this on Facebook and on YouTube.
That you support no fly, no buy.
And I don't. I think the no fly list is a joke. And I've thought that for quite a while. We've never really talked about it much, but
no,
you know, it's never really come up.
I honestly did not know your opinion about that until right this moment.
Yeah, no, it's ridiculous. And you can find case study after case study over the last 3, 4, 5 years of people who have incorrectly been put on that list, have been misidentified and put on that list. There are so many problems with that list. They found 2-year-olds and 3-year-olds on that list.
Yeah.
I mean, the history of this list, it's a total bunglefuck of nonsense. And it is not something that actually would have even stopped the Orlando shooting.
No.
So my disappointment with the Democrats is great over this no buy, no fly sit-in. Because they had an opportunity to actually grab onto something that was substantial and meaningful
right.
legally with gun control. They could have sat in over, I don't know, something to do with background checks, something to do with regulations, something to do with licensing. They could have, there are so many other aspects of this that would have been an effective move forward for gun control. And instead, these idiots sit there for 24 hours, you know, making great civil protest and periscoping and making great press, and I actually laud them for doing that, but doing it for the, but now I'm criticizing them because they did it over the wrong damn thing. And maybe the only good thing I can see about this is maybe that action will spurn conversation and more debate about this issue and move the ball forward. Maybe it won't. Maybe it'll just be another useless political gesture, and they're using it to score points. I don't know.
Maybe it's just their start.
Maybe. Maybe so. And wouldn't that be nice?
Yeah, right? I mean,
because you can just this was
tiptoe at, yeah. would be better than standing still.
Agreed. Agreed. And that's why I think I validate it for doing something better than nothing.
Mm-hmm.
I validate that. Big, huge kudos and thumbs up for doing something.
Yeah, of course.
But please do something effective. I mean, I don't think that given the fact that our representatives are paid and there to be effective at their job, you know, I don't know. I just don't know that that's too much to ask of our politicians. I know it's crazy. I know. I'm going to hear about it.
Well, I mean, it's not too much to ask for someone who thinks the way that you think. For somebody who thinks the way that our comments are that we were talking about before, it was too much to ask. So, I mean, you know, lawmakers, policymakers, congressmen, senators, representatives, they're there to support their people. And a lot of times they are supporting their people the way that they vote. A lot of times, though, they are supporting the people who give them money, which is what I have a bigger problem with.
Well,
I don't have a problem with big government. I have a problem with deep-pocket corporations telling me how to live my life. That's what I don't like. That's my big issue with gun control right now, is that we're not talking about what we need to talk about, because people like corporations, like the NRA... and other people, like gun manufacturers, are basically stopping the conversation.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm not okay with.
Well, it's funny you mention that, because our next story actually gets into that a little bit. And also, on that point, I will reiterate something I've said before, that, and I'm sure I will say it many, many more times in the future. It's not wrong for us to be mad right now.
No.
What the problem is that we're mad about the wrong things. Right, we are not informed, or we don't inform ourselves adequately to get mad at the right part of the problem, and so we get all over here when we should be on this. And I think it's really a reflection of us not being adequately informed, whether we're being purposefully misinformed or we're not taking the time to inform ourselves enough about the problems or issues, or a little bit of both. Right? People get all conspiracy
well,
about this stuff. But
we've come down to a society that learns in blips.
Yeah, it's the meme society.
That's it really is. I mean,
meme news.
Meme. Meme.
Meme.
Meme. Meme. Meme news.
Me.
I sounded like a minion.
All right. This this is politics section from US Uncut. This is I've never seen this website before, but. See how much the NRA paid your senator to vote against gun reform. Now, this came across my plate. This was dated 2 days ago from Tom Cahill. Link below, as usual. And I thought this was actually... We're not going to get into reading this entire list or anything. But I thought this was interesting. Don't know if this... I'm not speaking to the veracity of this article as to whether this is absolutely true or not. But there's some interesting stuff thrown up here, and maybe some of you guys can let us know about it. The National Rifle Association paid a lot of money to the 53 members of the U.S. Senate who voted against expanding background checks and banning terror suspects from buying firearms. America's largest gun lobby contributed to the campaigns of 50 Republican senators who voted against the latest gun reform legislation this last Monday. And we're talking about amounts ranging from $2,500 to $7.7 million, John McCain.
Bitch.
So, over the course of the 50 senators' careers, the NRA contributed a total of $36 million, according to data compiled by the Center for American Progress Action Fund. 22 of those guys are up for re-election this year. So you can check out the article and see the names. I'm not going to read them all here. But it does make a point. The U.S., and we've talked about this before, so here's some numbers for you in terms of the importance of the midterm elections that are coming up. The U.S. Senate is currently made up of 54 Republicans, 45 Democrats, and one independent. This means that out of the 22 Senate races, Democrats only need to have a gain of 5 seats in this year's election to retake the Senate. So, there you go. Just some couple of, they list here the names and phone numbers of the D.C. offices for the senators and how much the NRA has given them. And a couple of fun numbers throwing out here. $1.4 million to Roy Blunt, Republican from Missouri.
Mm-hmm.
We have here, I mean, some of this is real nickel and dime stuff. Some of it is not. $2.8 million to Bill Cassidy from
Louisiana.
Let's see
really?
Here. $1.9 million, almost $2 million to Tom Cotton from Arkansas. Just a good old boy.
Dude from Arkansas, whose last name is Cotton. Not surprised.
Joni Ernst, Republican from Iowa, $3.1 million. Cory Gardner, Republican from Colorado. Colorado, dude, really? $3.8 million.
That is the... Oh, that's the guy who emailed me after I emailed him and said, could you please support a bill that helps for more sensible sex education? He goes, well, we're spending too much money and government is... There's too much government in the schools. Fuck you, Cory Gardner.
John McCain, Republican from Arizona, $7.7 million. David Perdue, Republican from Georgia, $1.8 million. So this is quite a bit of money that's being flowed into these guys'... oh, and Tom Tillis, Republican from North Carolina, our favorite state, $4.4 million.
Are you surprised?
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, does any of this shock you?
Well, yeah.
Tiny? Tiny yeah. Or like a lot?
Yeah, it does.
Because I'm not surprised.
Yeah.
In the slightest.
I know, and I shouldn't be either. But
I'm surprised about how much Cory Gardner got.
Dude. Yeah, and John McCain and Tom Tiller or whatever, this guy from North Carolina. Okay, so good. Now, we've now spent a good amount of time on the show here on guns. We're going to move on to something else that actually
Please.
Happened. Under the radar, maybe you guys noticed this and maybe you didn't, but this was actually probably even more, well, let's just say as important, because this was another Supreme Court decision that happened this week that has everything to do with your own rights and security as a United States citizen. We're talking here about the Fourth Amendment. Now, this was a hit to the Fourth Amendment as reported here on the New York Times. This is an opinion piece, editorial on this, but basically we're just going to talk about what happened. Now, the Fourth Amendment, in case some of you guys need to catch up on this, has to do with unlawful search and seizure, right? Police officers are not supposed to, or anybody in authority, FBI agents, CIA guys, whoever, aren't supposed to come up to you and you're just minding your own business walking down the street.
Right.
They're not supposed to be able to come up and just search you.
Right.
Right? They can't just walk into your home and search you or search your home. There's requirements in order for them to be able to do that. And now, that's not necessarily the case.
Some people can probably argue that cops all over have been doing a stop and frisk for decades.
Yeah.
I mean, that's been a big thing.
What happened here is in Utah, that happened. And... and we'll give you the specifics of it here. And this was taken all the way to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court came back with, I don't know any other way to describe this except a bad decision.
Right.
And Justice Sotomayor actually, in her dissenting opinion on this, laid out some facts and figures that were pretty convincing as to why this was a bad decision. But that didn't stop Clarence Thomas and the conservative judges from moving forward on this. So, Monday. Making it easier for law enforcement to evade its requirement that stops, if they're going to stop you, that it be based on reasonable suspicion. The justices ruled 5-3 that a police officer's illegal stop of a man on the street did not prevent evidence obtained from a search connected to that stop to be used against him. Okay, now this is important. If you were stopped, right, and let's say you were a wrongdoer. Let's say you had drugs on you. Let's say you had a gun on you that wasn't licensed. Let's say whatever. But the police officer did not have a reasonable suspicion to stop you. Well, now, if he didn't have that reasonable suspicion to stop you, any evidence he finds in searching you, he can now use against you, whereas before this decision, that evidence would have been inadmissible in court.
Yep.
That's really the bottom line on this. And you think, well, I'm not an evil wrongdoer, so what's the problem? Yeah.
I hate that argument. Well, if you have nothing to hide, then you shouldn't care about
this. Yeah, invasion of privacy isn't an issue if you're not being private, right?
Do you know how many people get tickets for things that they didn't know were illegal?
Yeah.
All the time.
Now, just to give a little background on this. This is Utah versus Strife. The police in Salt Lake City got an anonymous tip of drug activity in a house. Okay? An officer monitoring the house became suspicious at the number of people entering and leaving, right? So they have this place under surveillance. One of those people, Edward Strife, left the house to walk to a nearby convenience store. The officer went and stopped him and asked for his ID. A routine check revealed that Mr. Strife had an outstanding small traffic warrant. The officer arrested him based on that earlier warrant, searched him, and found drugs in his pockets. Now, the state of Utah actually agreed that the initial stop was illegal because it wasn't based on reasonable individual suspicion of Mr. Strife. He's just some guy walking in and out of a house.
Right.
So, the state argued that the discovery of the valid warrant after the illegal stop got around the Fourth Amendment violation. In other words, he had a warrant out, but they didn't know that before they stopped him. So the state of Utah is like, see, we were right. And the Utah Supreme Court rejected that argument. And they were right for doing that. But they took it up to the Supreme Court, and Justice Clarence Thomas wrote in the majority opinion that it was a good faith mistake and that the illegal stop was at worst an isolated instance of negligence.
Okay, they had to have known that making this a good faith, whatever, they had to have known that this would have caused a ripple effect for other people.
Of course they had to know that. And you know, when people talk to me and start accusing me of, like, big government, well, if I support big government, I would be applauding this decision, wouldn't I?
Because you have nothing to hide.
This is ridiculous. This is an absolute clear-cut violation of the Fourth Amendment. It's ridiculous that this happened.
Really, Clarence?
Yeah, really, Clarence? Thanks, Clarence. Now I'm going to be accused of being a racist.
No, and that's the thing. That's what kills me, the fact that he is an African-American, and he's saying that, oh, yeah, no, this was a faith-based thing. Dude,
well, you can't, you know, we can't profile the Supreme Court any more than we can profile anybody else, right?
I can profile whoever I feel like.
Yeah, well, Justice Sotomayor said, do not be soothed by the opinion's technical language. This case allows the police to stop you on the street, demand your identification, and check it for outstanding traffic warrants, even if you are doing nothing wrong. She acknowledged the temptation to let the officer get away with his own wrongdoing, since his instincts, although unconstitutional, were correct, misses a basic principle of the Fourth Amendment. Two wrongs don't make a right.
Right.
Right? Responding to Justice Thomas's unsupported claim that the violation of Mr. Strife's rights was an isolated case, Justice Sotomayor pointed out that the police in Salt Lake City and nationwide routinely run warrant checks on people they have illegally stopped. Combine that practice with a staggering, she says, staggering number of outstanding warrants, 8 million all around the country, and cops have an even greater incentive to stop anyone for any reason, knowing the odds are good that they will find a warrant and be able to make an arrest and conduct a search. So, That is your Fourth Amendment going down the tubes. And, you know, this Supreme Court has made some decisions that are good, i.e. gay marriage. Mm-hmm. This Supreme Court has made some decisions that are staggeringly stupid.
Right.
The whole corporations as a person thing. Right? Yeah. Which, by the way, I'm hearing and seeing that Ruth Bader Ginsburg from the Supreme Court is actually trying to file motions to get that overturned.
I love her so much.
Go Ruth. So,
that's right, go Ruth. Yeah.
So, yeah. All right.
Ruths are awesome people.
I will actually agree with that. I will totally agree with that.
You should agree with that.
I will agree with that.
Everyone should agree with that.
All right. Now, on a separate note, totally moving on past government now.
You should also agree that Twizzlers are better than Red Vines.
Yeah. Hey, Team Red Vines, I need to hear from you people out there. I need to hear from you. Red Vines. Red
Vines. Twizzlers.
Okay. So, Ken Hamm. One of our favorite people in the whole world.
I despise this man.
Oh, we do love Ken Hamm. This is from, actually, this actually was reported on Raw Story. Goes back to Fox 13 from Salt Lake City. Again, link below. State supports Noah's Ark theme park, not all residents on board. Now, this is actually out of, this was reported on Fox 13 Salt Lake City, but this is actually from Williamstown, Kentucky. Okay, that's where this is happening.
Yeah.
And what we have is Ken Hamm has gotten a lot of money together in order to build an Ark Museum. Okay, an Ark, not as in Raiders of the Lost Ark or the Lost Ark of the Covenant. We're talking about Noah's Ark. Okay, he's had construction crews out there for months building what, according to the Bible, was built by a family of 12. This gigantic monstrosity. That apparently is their idea of what Noah's Ark looked like when it transported 15 million species of animals and plants to save them from the genocidal god who decided to destroy the entire planet because he got pissed at some people. And if I'm making light of your religious beliefs, that's on purpose because I think that story is ridiculous. And if you actually believe that's literal truth, please go open a science book. I'm not even kidding, and it might sound totally intolerant, but I'm sorry. It's just the facts. There's no way that Ken Hamm's interpretation of that story is in any way, shape, or form any kind of valid fact-based anything. So here's the problem.
I like atheist Chris. It's hilarious.
So here's the problem. Ken Hamm has got this museum going in Kentucky. It's been under construction for quite some time. It has received millions of dollars in state support, and the reason for that is because the state governor, and let me see if I can look up his name here. The state of Kentucky is on board. $18 million in sales tax incentives. So thank you very much, Kentucky. Yes, Matt Bevin, Governor Matt Bevin, has been fully on board with this. And the reason, of course, for that is any fool can see that this is going to create millions and millions of dollars in revenue for the state through taxation because people are going to be coming and visiting this thing just like they come and visit Disneyland. And Ken Hamm knows that. And he might be an ignoramus when it comes to science, but he does understand the bottom line. And that's what's happening here. So Kentucky is fully on board with supporting this. Now here's where it gets a little tricky.
The only reason where they're actually entertaining this concept is because Ken Hamm is also the idiot behind the Creation Museum. Even atheists go to that because we want to giggle.
That's right.
But that's
and we
that's
pays our
why.
Money and we and, gets our
well,
giggles.
They. You know? They tried to block him from receiving money because he wanted to only let Christians work for him. They're like, well, if you're going to be getting these tax incentives, you can't put some kind of religious test on an application. Yeah, he can.
Yeah, he actually can. And this week, and the reason we're talking about this with this news story is I'm not trying to hate on the guy for his religion, actually, but I am hating on him for his unfair employment practices. And specifically what I'm talking about is this. Employees going to work at the Ark Encounter, is what it's called, have a little catch, okay? Not just anybody can go work there. Employees are required to sign a statement of faith disavowing homosexuality, same-sex marriage, and premarital sex. They must also believe in Genesis and Jesus Christ. So, should you fit the bill for those requirements, or at least be willing to sign that you fit that bill, then and only then do you get to have a job at the Ark Encounter. And guess what? That is a clear-cut violation of the separation of church and state, and about, I don't know, four or five laws on the books about anti-discrimination in the workplace.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, I feel like I'm a little out on a limb right now. Not. But, you know, if somebody wants to debate this, I guess they can. But this is kind of ridiculous. Now, get this, and this was the best part about this story. Not everyone's on board with Hamm's plan. Baptist minister Bob Fox, and I'm not sure where they got him from, but Bob Fox specifically says, "I believe as a Baptist in the separation of church and state, and I don't think that the state ought to be involved in promoting any particular religious views." Go Bob.
Way to go, Bob.
Even further, there's kinds of laws called Sharia, where people have used legislation in the government to promote a religious faith. And I think we as Christians need to be careful that we continue to be Christian, and to be Christian in the context of the United States.
Wow, Bob.
Thank you, Bob. Okay, now I know I'm absolutely positive that most of you out there totally agree with this and are not, you know, religious fundamentalists who think that I'm talking Martian here. But it's nice to see somebody step up who is of the faith and call out this kind of practice for what it is.
Right.
And the hypocrisy of what this is.
And I'm glad that he brought up the concept of Sharia law. My own brother-in-law, and I think I've said this on our podcast before, I've written a blog about it before. My own brother-in-law was like, oh, sign this petition to stop Sharia law from becoming law in the United States. And I had to remind him, hey, there's this thing called a separation of church and state, and it stops stuff from like that from happening, which is why we need it. And it appeals, or it goes along with your religion as well. So your religion stays out, other religion stays out, and we all live happy. That's the way this country is supposed to be. And it's just, I'm just like Chris, I'm happy that a Baptist, for God's sakes, came out and actually said that. And it's like, dude, bless you. I mean, that was amazing.
Exactly. And I'm sure that, like I said, I'm sure the majority of you guys, regardless of your faith, actually totally support what we just talked about, right? And regardless of my, you know, statements about belief there, that's not the issue. Never was the issue, no part of the issue. My own personal feelings about Noah's Ark notwithstanding, this is a clear-cut violation of the law, and it needs to be called out as such. And Ken Hamm needs to be called on the carpet for doing this kind of thing. It's not acceptable.
No.
Now, we have the best story ever. Okay, now okay. Anybody...
No, Chris, no, I'm just going to go ahead. I'm going to preface this just real fast. Chris is way more excited about this than I am. And I think you'll know why in about 2 seconds.
Oh, this is great.
Because he sent it to me and I went, oh, uh-huh. Yeah. And he's been giggling about it for like 3 hours.
This is the best story ever.
Go ahead.
This is literally hours old, okay? Now,
go ahead.
I'm giving a shout out to my good friend, Tony Ortega. Tony has a daily blog called The Underground Bunker, and any of you who follow any of my Scientology stuff are going to know who this guy is. But for those of you who don't, Tony Ortega is a real good guy. In fact, I just spent the weekend in Cleveland, Ohio at a meetup where a bunch of people who comment on his blog regularly decided to meet in real life. We called it HowdyCon. And I flew out there and kind of, you know, had some fun out there at HowdyCon for the weekend.
Sorry, what?
Yeah, HowdyCon, yeah. Because there was a commenter named Howdy on his blog, and, you know, he passed, and they named it after him. It was HowdyCon.
Okay, it's no longer stupid
year,
funny, sorry.
Next year, HowdyCon is going to be here in Denver, so I won't have to fly off anywhere. Uh-huh, that's right.
Great.
I know. So, anyway, HowdyCon was a lot of fun. Now, getting to the point here, this story came out hours ago, and it's, you know, any of you guys who have watched my videos or listened to us talk about conspiracy theories know that we just love them for their raw, sheer stupidity. I mean, they just, it's amazing. And, you know, whenever I open my mouth about this, you know, somebody's always got something to say, and I love it, you know, bring it on, because, you know, people, you know, I know that there are real conspiracies, that people do conspire to take advantage of us and people in other countries and bankers and this and that, that there are these people, they do exist, these conspiracies do happen. But this nonsense that flies around and has been flying around for, you know, for at least the last couple decades on the internet about the Illuminati and the 12 bankers and the IMF and the Federal Reserve System and the 9/11 truthers and these what I call the global conspirators, right? Like this idea that there's this vast global conspiracy of thousands of people led by this, you know, brain trust of bankers or international financiers who are slowly eroding away our rights in the name of world domination and control. I just have to giggle because it's ridiculous. Well, it doesn't make any logical sense.
Dude, now, you're killing me.
Okay, now, this story, though, has got to be the best conspiracy theory I've seen in a long time. Maybe not the best one ever, but today on The Bunker, there's a guy who used to be a Scientologist, and his name is Randy McDonald, and he's still a believer in L. Ron Hubbard and Scientology. And there's an interesting thing, okay? L. Ron Hubbard was a conspiracy theorist himself, and he pushed this off on Scientologists, so much so that I used to even buy into some of this shit. So I know where the mind goes with this. And there's still, even amongst ex-Scientologists, there's this conspiracy-minded ideas, right? And one of them that you guys should know about is that Scientology, that L. Ron Hubbard, was himself the target of these conspirators because he developed Scientology. And Dianetics and Scientology are the way to undo mind control and brainwashing, and therefore became the target of the CIA, the KGB, the Illuminati, all these groups who wanted to usurp control of Scientology for their own ends, their own nefarious, twisted, evil ends, right? And that's what came out today. This is just, it just gets so good. So Randy McDonald wrote a book that is called, under the pseudonym Ashton Gray, and it's called Watergate the Hoax. And I'm not recommending any of y'all read this thing. It's just, boy.
It's probably ridiculously rambling long.
Probably so. Now, here's the crux of this, though. I just have to share this with you guys because it's just so good. So he's proposing a theory that James McCord, who was amongst the five burglars arrested at the Watergate Hotel on June 17th, 1972, harken back to Watergate. So James McCord, E. Howard Hunt, and G. Gordon Liddy used the Watergate break-in so they could be arrested and then confess to it. Okay, they did this all on purpose, all in an attempt to cover up what they'd really been doing just a few weeks before, kidnapping and assassinating L. Ron Hubbard in Morocco. Now, like Tony says here, and I'm just going to, you know, totally read from his words here, we bet Woodward and Bernstein didn't see that one coming. Now, Tony went through the book and discusses some things about it here, and he says, the book rests on the idea that the CIA in 1950 had decided, with the help of the Soviets, to enslave the world's population through mind control, just as L. Ron Hubbard was doing the opposite, freeing mankind with his new invention, Dianetics. And this is a quote from the book. Dianetics was a dire threat to the entire psycho establishment, its big pharma twisted sisters, and the CIA. Dianetic processes had exposed the very techniques that the CIA, the KGB, and the psycho establishment on both sides were using in their tireless, costly, and very secret efforts to create a Manchurian candidate, a sort of automaton who would carry out post-hypnotic commands laid in with pain, drug, and hypnosis. Dianetics could penetrate the veil of amnesia that the CIA and its psycho-establishment sycophants had labored so long to be able to produce in its subjects, And Dianetics even could reveal the very methods that had been used to create the amnesia. So, yeah. So then Tony says, the biggest threat to this worldwide conspiracy, okay, CIA, KGB, whole number, was Hubbard and then his OT levels, right? The top secret stuff Hubbard came up with in the 1960s that only high-ranking Scientologists can gain access to after they've spent huge amounts of money. The CIA and the KGB could hardly contain themselves. They wanted to get their hands on this stuff and see what Hubbard could do with the mind force involved in OT powers. So, then once he released the later OT levels, the upper levels in 1968, he all but assured his own doom. That sealed Hubbard's fate, and that is what set into motion Watergate, the hoax. So, yeah. So in case, you know, any of you guys were wondering what's really going on, it's not the Illuminati. It's not, you know, the reptile lizard men who are, you know, in positions of royalty and executive power in every government on Earth. That's not what's going down. That's all just nonsense. What's really going down is the CIA, the KGB, and their psycho-establishment partners who are trying to take over the world and actually put down a president and all his willing accomplices on purpose in order to cover up what they were really doing and getting hold of the materials of Dianetics and Scientology. Yeah. It's got to be the most awesome conspiracy theory I have ever heard. So, there you go. I first read that and I was speechless. Truly speechless.
I like that picture right there.
Yeah, and apparently, tinfoil dog. This guy Randy McDowell, according to a friend of mine, is under, you know, the idea that, let's just say he's got some funny ideas about things beyond just this conspiracy theory.
I've got some funny ideas about Randy.
Guess you can look him up and see about that. So, anyway, I thought that might be a little humorous anecdote here. And one last thing, since we're running out of time here, but I just had to hit this one. I have to hit this one.
Jesus Christ.
I have to.
Are you serious?
Yes. Yes, it's too good to ignore. You know, this is Bloomberg.com. Again, link below. This is just pure awesome. Burger King. Go Burger King. I'm actually going to go over to Burger King and see if I can find evidence that they're doing this. But they are now offering a new trial. They're testing out this new... new offering.
It's a monstrosity, is what it is.
It's
this
in a little
thing
carton.
is monstrous.
The new product is called Mac and Cheetos, and it's from the partnership of Frito-Lay, Cheetos, and basically it is Cheetos. It's the big fat ones, right? The fluffy Cheetos.
Puffy.
But they're, yeah, the puffy kind.
I'm lactose intolerant, but I'm still a fat girl. They are called puffy. Thank you very much.
And they're stuffed with mac and cheese, little mac and cheese bits. And you can buy these at Burger King. And they're, you know, this deep fried snack.
Looks like someone took mac and cheese, rolled it around in Cheetah dust, and like fried it, and it looks like little noodles and all that.
Yes.
And it's awful.
I can't wait. It's only $2.49 for a 5-pack. And they're going to be sold for about 8 weeks or until supplies run out, said Burger King. And has 310 calories, and it's already appeared in a trial phase. We're partnering with one of America's favorite brands. It's quite unique, said the Burger King representative.
This is...
I gotta get me some of these.
This is like how Taco Bell tried to do the whole Dorito taco shell stuff.
Yeah, those were kind of tasty too.
I've actually never had one of those.
Yeah, Cool Ranch really taco gross. Shell. Yeah,
no, they had the nacho.
Yeah.
I never had one because it looked awful.
No, they were tasty.
Ugh.
They were tasty. Now, of course, I say that in full knowledge of the fact that I don't really eat a Taco Bell too much anymore because it upsets my tummy.
What? Yeah, well,
But I mean, these mac and Cheetos. I mean, here's the thing. You know, if any of you guys get a chance to go to the Cheesecake Factory, one of the best things, and this is probably, I mean, maybe this is like product placement or something. I don't know. Maybe I shouldn't be saying this, but they have these mac and cheese balls that are to die
Okay, that's
for.
Just mean. That's They're mean. So you good. Know I'm lactose intolerant. That's
They're
mean.
So good.
That's mean. Ugh. Stop being mean.
Okay. I'll stop abusing you and your lactose intolerance.
Goddamn patriarchy.
I'm evil and I must be destroyed.
Obviously.
So with that, we have reached the end of another episode of our Sensibly Speaking podcast. Perhaps mac and Cheetos are not as sensible as we might pretend that they could be, but I just had to throw that out there. So if any of you get a chance to try any of those, let us know how they are. I'm curious as to your reaction.
No.
Curious?
Seek help. Go to your nearest emergency room. Have your stomach pumped.
All right. So thanks for coming around and checking us out again. Again, please tell your friends and family about us. Let them know that we're out here throwing out crazy, wild, insane notions of sensibility and rationality and hoping that people will somehow glom onto our insanity.
As Chris says, be forceful.
Yes, exactly.
Don't take no.
That's right. Don't take no for an answer.
Perpetuate a rape culture.
Jesus. Wow.
We need to pick a different deity, because I've said Jesus Christ and goddamn it a lot, and you just said Jesus.
I did. Wow. Thor's
hand. Hare Krishna!
Yeah. Wow. So.
I don't know.
Leave your comments. Leave your feedback. Send us emails. Send us communications. We love to hear from you guys. We really do. And until next week, we will see you guys later.
Bye, y'all. Thanks.